Welcome to the course of Operating System. Today we have a first lecture, and during this first lecture I am going to cover substantially the definition of what is an operating system, then what it means to work in the two substantial operating modes that we have in an operating system, as a kernel and as a user, and then we will see possible representation of an operating system. We will have a review of how operating systems have evolved over time, and then we will go to see what are the key components of the operating system, having a very short and fast vision of what we are going to cover throughout all the lecture of a course. At the end of a course, we will talk about how to start up an operating system, and we will discuss about the wide number of operating systems which are currently available and which surround our life. So now we start defining what is an operating system. Now, operating systems are present everywhere, so you may have already some idea of what an operating system could be. We say that an operating system is a piece of running software, so it's a process which acts as an interface between the operator and the hardware, acting as a support to execute their programs. So the operating system is a layer of software, we said, that provides the user a better, a simpler, and a cleaner model to access the computer hardware. And it provides a way to handle all of what we call computer resource. What is a computer resource? A computer resource is every piece of hardware or software which is attached to the computer and which is accessible to the user. Example of resources are the webcams, are the headsets, but also printers, Bluetooth devices. All of these are resources, memory, processor, all are resources that the operating system allows the user to access in a better, simpler, and cleaner way. Now, we said we need now to see what are the ways in which we can operate in an operating system. In an operating system, we can have what we call a kernel mode and a user mode. So, first of all, operating systems are written by programmers who have the possibility of touching the inner part of an operating system. So people who can access and work on the hardware of the operating system. This lower level part is what we have signaled in our slides in red and partially in green, and is what we call the kernel mode. Then we have users who are not experienced programmers, may not know anything about programming. This user access the operating system for various purposes, most of which may have nothing to do with programming, such as browsing the web, sending the email, checking their calendar. Or they may even write some program which interface with a low part of a system. This user, we say, access the operating system in user mode. So we have two operating modes, a kernel mode and the user mode. A kernel mode is for experienced people, and it is also called the supervisor mode, and people in kernel mode have complete access to the entire hardware of the operating system. And the user can execute any instruction, so the user in kernel mode can execute any instruction that the machine is capable of executing. The rest of the machine works in user mode. So, when in user mode, a user can access only a limited part of instruction which are present in the machine, because the user may not be experienced. So when we talk about user mode, we refer to regular users, not experienced users, people who may have no IT background at all. And the subset of instruction that the user can access in this user mode are instruction which satisfy his goal of using the computer, but do not allow her or him to touch any internal part which may damage the operational aspect of a computer system, of an operating system. And indeed, input-output typically are forbidden in user mode. They can occur because the user may issue a request to the system, which is called a system call, to access the low-level part of a system, the kernel part, and to execute the instruction of input-output. And the system determines if it is possible, and if so, it executes this instruction. Okay, we have seen now the two fundamental modes of an operating system. As we said, now we can cover the perception of what is an operating system for the user. So we can view the operating system substantially in two modes, a top-down view and a bottom-up view. We start from the top-down view. Now, we know that the hardware is difficult to access. Normally, none of us would be able to interface directly with the hardware. That was done with the very first computer, where programming was done by wiring, but not anymore today. So given the complexity of the hardware, it's important to create abstraction which simplify our interface with that. When we say that we perceive the operating system as an extended machine, it means we perceive the operating system as an extension of the computational infrastructure with simplified activities which make possible for the user to interact effectively, not having the necessity of looking at the details, difficult details, which are inside the computer hardware. Now, when we talk about bottom-up view instead of a computer, we refer to the fact that the operating system need to be able to manage all the different pieces, so the task of the operating system is to provide a well-structured, orderly, clean approach to access all the different elements which are inside our computer, such as the processor, the memory, the I/O devices, and all the different peripherals which could be present. Now, being able to access to resource is also referred to as sharing resources or multiplexing resources, and can be done substantially in two ways. We can have time multiplexing or space multiplexing. Time multiplexing means that I allocate a resource to a given user at a given amount of time, at a given instant of time. So I share the resources, giving these resources to different users at different instances of time. By space multiplexing, I mean that I take a resource, I divided it into parts, and I give to different users different parts of this resource. A typical example of time multiplexing is a printer, where I have one resource which I share, giving it to a different instance of time to different users. An example of space multiplexing is given, for instance, by memory, where I split the memory in different chunks and I give each of these different chunks to different user, with the user perceiving as if they have a complete control of the entire memory of the operating system, but actually they have only a little part of it. We are now going to have a short and fast review of how the operating system evolved throughout the history.
Legendary names, legendary inventions. But who invented one of the most significant inventions of all time, the computer? Many embarked on the quest to invent such a machine, but who was first? And what machine qualifies as the first real computer? In 1834, British mathematician Charles Babbage conceived of the analytical engine, a machine with a memory and calculating unit which could be programmed. The analytical engine was never built, but would it have worked? In 1991, a difference engine based on a simpler Babbage design was built. It operates exactly as Babbage predicted, 150 years earlier. Can mathematical statements be proved true or false? This question became the foundation of theoretical computer science. Alan Turing, a British mathematician and cryptanalyst, imagined a machine that could compute any problem that was presented in a set of instructions. In essence, a general-purpose computer. The Universal Turing Machine was a conceptual blueprint for automatic computation. Meanwhile, German engineer Konrad Zuse built a series of machines for his calculations. Zuse's Z3 was the earliest fully functioning program-controlled machine. But war isolated Zuse, and his work wasn't widely known. Technology advances in World War II catapulted computing into a new modern era. American physicist John Mauchly and engineer Presper Eckert built the ENIAC, the first all-electronic computer controlled by a program. It was much faster than previous machines, but had no memory to store programs, and needed to be tediously rewired for each problem. After the war, ENIAC was declassified and unveiled to members of the scientific community.
We start, first of all, with the very, very first computer developed during World War II and right after. These computers were huge, were based on vacuum tubes, required a lot of energy because they needed air conditioning to cool down, and they were mostly programmed with wires. Then they were programmed also using punched cards and other paper tapes.
At the Moore School of Electrical Engineering at the University of Pennsylvania, they were very, very strong in computation because there were engineers back then who were moving more toward not just how you do things based on what people did before, but to break new frontiers. And as they did that, the mathematical complications became difficult to solve. So they needed a machine. So they decided electrons are faster, we'll move them through these tubes, and we'll click them on and off, and we'll make a machine that would solve these equations. They created the world's first all-electronic, general-purpose digital computer. When the war started, they were picked especially to do computations for the Army for long guns and the firing tables.
ENIAC was revolutionary in being the first large-scale, general-purpose, electronic digital computer ever built, and led to the evolution towards modern computer technology by developing the stored program architecture that is the fundamental architecture for all computers today.
They solved these equations that they thought would take 2 years in 2 hours. A maybe it is. So the world changed.
You know, without ENIAC and the University of Pennsylvania and the city of Philadelphia, we wouldn't have Google, we wouldn't have Microsoft, we wouldn't have, you know, the things that are driving today's economy and the rapid innovation that keep happening in computer devices.
People just create things even if they're not being prompted to. That's what human beings are about.
You need new knowledge to start something new in the marketplace. So people create knowledge. Knowledge is inherently human.
This computer typically didn't have an operating system. And then there was a major change in technology. Transistors were introduced. At this time, we had the time of a mainframes and of a batch system. Batch system means computer which were executing one program at a time. So transistor arrived, increased the power, and allowed the miniaturization of computer, which required less energy, and therefore were also more powerful. At this time, we had the first operating system, as we said, the batch operating system. At that time, also programs were written not anymore any longer only with wiring, but also with machine language and with assembly language. Magnetic tape and disk were used in order to store data and programs. Then we had the third generation of computers. The path which started with the introduction of transistor went on with the creation, with adoption of integrated circuits. This produced further miniaturization of computers. This further miniaturization of computers resulted in the possibility of performing multi-programming, which means multiple programming running at the same time, spooling, which is simultaneous peripheral operation online, of which we'll talk later on, and time sharing, which means giving a single amount of time very fast to different users or different programs, giving the impression that there are multiple processors working at the same time while there is only one processor, switching very fastly between processes and users. A typical example was the IBM 360. And the third generation can be divided in two sides. The first one, which was just based on integrated circuits, which is based on this large mainframe, which were accessed through terminals. And then the second one, which started in the mid-60s and went on, saw the introduction of a personal computer, where LSI, large-scale integration, and VLSI, very large-scale integration technology, was used, and write technology was used for data storage, and computers were started for using in data communication. Programming languages were used. Also in the first generation, people started to have the first typical programming languages that we see today. Pascal was done at that time, C was done at that time, and then the computer were used in parallel processing, superconductor, speech recognition, intelligent robots, and artificial intelligence.
Mr. Johnson, this is the computer center. So sorry to call you this late, but the computer is available if you want to get your urgent work done.
Il calcolatore allora era una cosa che sembrava custodito da sacerdoti.
E sembrava di entrare in un ospedale quando si andava in una stanza del computer. C'era tutta gente in camice bianco.
Computers certainly could help to destroy human freedom. They can make war or peace.
Control, control, control. Every day you read in the newspapers that computers are controlling something else. It's my belief that the government will link up all the computers and we'll all be controlled. And there'll be no freedom left.
Excuse me, what do you think about computers?
We're terrified of them.
Until today. Because Olivetti have developed Programmer 101, the world's first desktop computer. The Programmer 101 is compact. The Programmer 101 is portable. The Programmer 101 sells at a fraction of the cost of a large computer.
The 101 is a real break in the history of computers. One from the mainframe to a thing on the desktop.
Poi eravamo i primi al mondo, non c'era niente di simile, no? Quindi c'era un po' una corsa a far presto.
in that advertisement where you see a businessman sitting at the side of a pool with a woman in a bathing suit doing a little calculation. It's a prophecy of the death of computers as something that's hidden away behind glass walls.
Welcome to the world of tomorrow. Climb aboard. You are about to take a journey out of this world into the world of the future.
C'era molta gente invece che pensava di è impossibile, non è vero, c'è un cavo sotterraneo, e andava a vedere intorno alla macchina se c'erano dei cavi nascosti che la collegavano attorno a un calcolatore.
Sarà come telefonare, come accendere la TV, come mettere in marcia l'auto. E forse, tra pochi anni, l'ironia sarà già vinta dalla realtà.
Il concetto del computer personale l'ha tirato fuori, l'ha introdotto nel 65, mi dispiace per gli americani, ma la 101.
This plastic society we live in, man, it needs a scapegoat, it goes to computers. Yeah, like wild.
Then we had the fourth generation of personal computer. We went on with a further level of integration and people started to develop what we call the micro computers. Always smaller, always more powerful, always requiring less energy. The Intel 8080 was the first CPU which was heavily used, and it had the root of the DOS operating system, which was always backward compatible till very recently to such CPU. And it was then the time when IBM gave the task to an external company called Microsoft to develop a disk operating system, the MS-DOS. And then we go to the fifth generation.
Newton communicates. What is Newton? Newton is digital. Newton is personal. Newton is magic. Newton is as powerful as a computer. Newton is as simple as a piece of paper. Newton is intelligent. Newton learns about you, understands you. Newton is news. Newton can receive a page, it sends faxes, and soon electronic mail. Newton lets you communicate with the whole world, and if there's anything this world could use, it is more communication.
Mobile computers. In the fifth generation, we see a widespread of the operating system across multiple devices which are not anymore just computers as we consider today. We saw it, the adoption on mobile phones, on handheld devices, and then overall throughout the home. In fact, we see that this computer, this operating system are now present on washing machines, are present on vacuum cleaners, are present on a variety of devices which support our life throughout. Now that we have seen a fast overview of how computers were used the operating system evolved throughout the history, we can focus and see the overall structure of the operating system as we will review it throughout the course. So, first we need to see what is our hardware model that we will use. You already saw in computer architecture that this is just a model. It means it's not that all the computers are done exactly in this way. But this model helps us to describe how the operating system works. This model consists of a processor, which performs the computation, of a main memory, where we store the data we need to perform the computation, the disks for secondary storage, I/O devices, and buses. First of all, the processor. You already know again from operating system that the basic cycle of the central processing unit is the following. First, the central processing unit fetch the instruction, decode the instruction to understand what needs to be done, compute the operands which need to be used, and then goes and fetch the operands, and then finally execute the instruction, and then stores the data, writes the operand in memory. In order to perform its computation, the CPU requires register to hold variables. So we have general registers used in order to hold variables. We have also the program counter, which keep us track of where our computation is going. We have a stack pointer, which points at the stack, at the top of the stack that we are currently using to perform our computation. And then we have a program status word, which are a set of bits of a result of a comparison operation, the CPU priority, the mode, which is kernel mode or user mode, of which we have already talked, and various other pieces of controlling bits, which are used in order to perform our computation. Now, so how all this operation work together? We can have, mainly as an abstraction, two different major models, the typical three-stage model, fetch, decode, execute, fetch, decode, execute, which can be put in pipeline, which means fetch, decode, execute can be parallelized with a second fetch, decode, execute. So when we have a fetch for one instruction, we have the decode for the second and the execute for the third. Or we can even have superscalar CPUs, where fetch and decode are pipelined together, and then we have a holding buffer and an executing unit for this. We already discussed during the history of operating system that we can have multi-programming and we can have time sharing for processor, which means that processor can execute, can give the impression of executing multiple programs for multiple users at the same time, while actually we have only one program being executed at a single amount of time by the processor. But we will see in this course also an additional approach, which is the approach of the so-called multi-threading. Multi-threading means that within one process there are multiple threads of execution, multiple flow of execution going in parallel. And this idea of multi-threading, or even the further hyper-threading, allows the CPU to hold the state of two or more threads and then switch between these threads in nanoseconds. If one of the processes needs to read a word from main memory, which is typically a long operation, a multi-threaded CPU can switch to another thread, and thus saving time. Indeed, multi-threading does not mean that we have multiple processors. It's just a virtualization done on a single processes. So here, then we can see, you know, a general structure of how multi-threading works. It means that we organize our application into one or multiple threads, and within one application, when an application requires to wait for data, we could have another thread of the same application occurring. With hyper-threading, we take this to a further level. And now many CPU chips have some complete processor or cores. Making use of such multi-core chip will require indeed a multiprocessor operating system. And a clear example of a multi-core operating systems, an operating system having multiple processes, is when we have GPUs. GPUs are graphical processing units. And it is a processor with thousands of tiny cores which are very good for very small operations done in parallel, like rendering polygon in graphic application, but also, for instance, mining bitcoins. So GPUs are very important elements in performing very high, very fast computation in today's computers. And if I have multi-core chips, indeed I have a real true parallelism, because I can have different operations being executed by different processors, by different cores at the same time. Here we can have an example of a quad-core chip with a shared L2 cache, or we could have a quad-core chip, each one with its own L2 cache. And now we started to talk about cache. So we started to talk about memory. Already from the course of computer architecture, you all know that memory is organized in a hierarchy of level. The top level are fast, small, and expensive. The low level are slower, larger, and cheaper. In this in the book, you will talk about memory and magnetic disk. Now we have other level of storage with also other technology, which is always evolving. And we can say that at the top level, we have a main memory, which is divided into cache lines. Typically, every cache line is of 64 bits. And the most heavily used cache line are kept in a high-speed cache located inside the CPU, as you already know from computer architecture. And when the program needs to read a memory word, the cache hardware checks to see if a line needed is in the cache. And if it is in the cache, which means it's a cache hit, no memory request is sent over to the bus to the main memory. And this normally takes about 2 clock cycles. Some machines have 2 or even 3 levels of cache, each one slower and bigger than the one before it. And the issue related to caching requires where to put a new item on the cache, which cache line to put the new item in, which item to remove from the cache when the slot is needed, and where to put the newly evicted item into larger memory. All these elements will be considered throughout the course when we will talk about memory management. And talking about this, we need to talk about the old division of memory into RAM and ROM. The RAM is a random access memory, where random does not mean, you know, chaotic. Random means that accessing this memory does not require to access one element after the other, like when I access a file. This serves all the CPU requests, which cannot be satisfied out of a cache. And then we have a ROM, read-only memory, which was very common in the early era of computers, still present today. And the ROM is where we put elements for read-only, and this information which is not lost when the power goes away. So we say the ROM, this term is also used heavily today for mobile operating system, to refer to memory which stays when I switch off my computer, and which is typically used at booting time. ROM have evolved, the ones were really ROM read-only, and then they started to be rewritable. So now we have even EEPROM, so electrically erasable, programmable ROM. And we have also flash memory, which are non-volatile. And flash memory is also commonly used as the storage medium in portable electronic devices. And it is in intermediate speed between the RAM and the disk. And many computers also use complementary CMOS memory to hold the current time and date and various configuration parameters, such as which disk to boot on. And now, so we talked about processor, we talked about main memory, we are going to talk about secondary memory very briefly, which means typically disks. Disks are like the old vinyl disks that you may have seen sometimes, or the CD disk, which means it's a platter. Typically there are multiple of them, put one over the other, where the data is stored. So in this case, if I have this disk of the set of disks, I have what is in the picture, a platter, and then I have an arm, an actuator arm, which moves and read, and then I have little heads which read and write, and I have a segment which is an arc on the track. I have a track and a sector into the track where I read my information. If I need to read information on the disk, as I said, this is non-random access memory, so it means it is sequential memory, so I need to have a seek time, which is a time which is needed to physically positioning to read the data. Then I have a rotation delay, which is the amount of time it takes for the disk to rotate to the required position, and then I have a transfer time to transfer the element in and back of the disk. Another component of operating system are the so-called I/O devices, input-output devices. Input-output devices are what we typically use when using computer. They are mouse, there are microphones, cameras, all sorts of goodies that we attach to computer. Typically, input-output devices consist of two parts, the device itself, and then a controller that accepts command from the operating system and carries this command out. On the side of the operating system, there is a piece of software which is called the device driver. This device driver talks to the controller, giving commands and accepting responses. And it has to be put into the operating system so it can run in kernel mode. Now, the importance of a device driver is that the device driver supplies to the operating system a common view of the different devices so that the operating system can interface to the different devices by class without, at the programming level, having to remember the details of every single possible device. Now, every controller has also a small number of registers that are used to communicate with this, and the collection of all this device register forms what is called the input-output port space. Now, on some computer, the device drivers are mapped into the operating system address space, so they can be read and written like ordinary memory word, like everything I get from a microphone, a specific microphone, is written at location 225. So I don't have to see from the programming level anything than location 235, because the data is stored there. There are other computers where the device driver are put in a special I/O port space, with each register having a specific port address. On this machine, especially in and out instructions are available in kernel mode to allow drivers to read and write registers. Input and output can be done in multiple different ways. There could be busy waiting, where the driver starts the operating, the input-output, and sits in a loop, continuously polling the device to see if it is done, and this has the disadvantage of blocking the CPU for a long time, as we will see much more in detail throughout the course. There could be interrupt, and you have already seen interrupt in computer architecture. The driver starts the device and asks it to give an interrupt when it is finished. The operating system then blocks the caller if need to be and looks for other work to be done. And when the controller detects the end of the transfer, it generates an interrupt to signal the completion. It is as if I go to a restaurant and then I ask the cooker, the kitchen, I ask the clerk to give me food through the kitchen. Then the kitchen is ordered, and then people get to talk, and then they get interrupted, and there is a ring that from the kitchen that the food is ready, and we get the food directly to our place. Now, the device number may be used as an index into part of memory to find the address of the interrupt handling for a device, and this part of memory is called the interrupt vector. Now we can see that there is a diagram showing the different steps in which this is done. So first we have starting an input-output device and getting the interrupt in the part A, and in the part B, the interrupt processing involves talking the interrupt, running the interrupt handler, and returning to the user program in order to achieve the goals that the user wanted. And then we have the so-called direct memory address.
also known as DMA. DMA is a chip that can control the flow of bits between memory and some controller without a constant CPU intervention. In a sense, it's a kind of parallel processing for dealing, talking to input-output devices. The CPU programs the DMA chip, telling what and where to transfer, and then lets it go. When the DMA chip is done, it causes an interrupt again, which is handled as described above. DMA may have the structure, so we see that the CPU talks and programs the DMA performs this operation, and at the end, through an interrupt, sends back the data, saving a lot of time. The next aspect that we need to talk, discussing how computer and operating system are organized, is the bus, actually the buses. Systems have many buses, each with a different transfer rate and function. The operating system must be aware of all of them for configuration and management. Shared bus architecture means that multiple devices use the same wires to transfer data, which need to be then arbitrated to determine who can use the specific bus. So there is an arbiter who determines who can use a specific bus. A parallel bus architecture means that you send each word of data over multiple wires, because the wires are put in parallel. For instance, in regular PCI buses, a single 32-bit number is sent to 32 parallel wires. And you have also already seen this into computer architecture. A serial bus architecture sends all the bits in a message through a single connection, known as the lane. Parallelism is still used because you can have multiple lanes in parallel. You can send 32 messages through 32 different lanes, but you don't have a large lane of 32 parallel wires. Now, double data rate, DDR3, DDR4, connect the CPU RAM for buses. And then we have a PCI, which are peripheral component interconnect, which is a bus used for external car devices. Then we have a DMI, which are direct media interface, a link between the north bridge and the south bridge, a hub for all other devices. Then we have SCSI and SATA, which connect hard disks. And, you know, once upon the time, you had to know about all devices, because on old computer you would see all the port for all these devices. Now, typically, in computer you see only the port related to the so-called USB, the Universal Serial Bus, of which is a centralized bus in which there is a root device for all the I/O devices to see if they have any traffic. USB are called plug and play in the sense that you put it and they work. And before plug and play, people sometimes say plug and pray, but we say plug and play. And before plug and play, each I/O card had a fixed interrupt request level and fixed addresses for its I/O register. And two different pieces of hardware might use the same interrupt, so they will conflict. Plug and play means the system automatically collects information about I/O devices and centrally assigning interrupt level and I/O addresses, and then tell to each card what numbers are there. Now, we are going to see what happens when I turn on a computer. Like, when I turn on a computer, it means I have to perform a sequence of operations so the computer starts to work. First of all, there is a concept, the BIOS, Basic Input-Output System. This is a program on the parent port that contain a low-level I/O software. So the BIOS is started, and so started to turn the machine on. After the BIOS is started, it performs the POST, Power On Self Test, to test integrity and to see how much RAM is installed and other basic devices which are installed and responding correctly. And then, booting the operating system, we have to start out by scanning the buses to detect all the devices attached to them. And then we need to determine the boot device by trying a list of all devices stored in the CMOS memory.
and we already saw what is the CMOS. And then we go on the boot sector, which is the first sector of a boot device, which is read into memory, and it is then executed. And the sector contains a program, which normally examines the partition table at the end of a boot sector to determine which partition is active. And then we load what is called the secondary bootloader, very important in mobile operating system. And this loader reads in the operating system from the active partition and starts it. The operating system then queries the BIOS to get the configuration information. For each device, it checks to see if it has a device driver. And then once it has all the device driver, the operating system loads them into the kernel. Then it initializes its table and it creates whatever background processes are needed and start a login program or a GUI. And we will now see very fast what we saw, a zoo of operating system. So we see that we started with mainframe operating system, very large system containing, you know, huge amount of wiring and of hardware. An example was the 360 IBM, very famous. And we have server operating systems still working today, running on Linux, Unix, or Windows 2000 and 90 and then whatever. We had multiprocessor operating system. We had personal computers. And then we have handheld computer, embedded their operating system, embedded operating system, sensor node operating system, real-time operating system, smart card operating system, all sorts of possible operating systems that you may think of. The mainframes, as we said, are room-sized computer in data center. The operating system for mainframe are heavily oriented toward processing many jobs at once, most of which need a prodigious amount of I/O. Typically, this mainframe operating system offered service for batch system processing routine job without any interactive action with the user. They were doing transaction processing system to handle large number of small requests, and they had some sort of time sharing to allow multiple remote users to run jobs on the computer at once, such as querying a big database. The server operating system run on server, which are either very large personal computer and workstation or even mainframe. They serve multiple users at once over a network, and this allows the user to share hardware and software resources. An example are, we know, Linux, Windows, then at that time we had Solaris, FreeBSD. Then we have multiprocessor operating system, which connect multiple CPU in a single system with parallel computers, multi-computer, multiprocessor. And nowadays, all PC and notebooks OS deal with small-scale multiprocessor. Example are Linux and Windows. And then we have a personal operating system. We know about all of them. macOS, FreeBSD, Linux, Windows, even Windows. And the handheld, like Android, Sailfish, iOS, and so on. And then we have the embedded, which run on computer which control device that are not generally thought as computers, and still they are computers, and typically they don't accept user-installed software. We talk about microwave ovens, MP3 players, TV cards, and examples of this are, for instance, embedded Linux, QNX, VxWorks. We have sensor node operating system, where every sensor node is a real computer with a CPU, a RAM, and a ROM, and one or more environmental sensors. This node communicates with each other and with a base station using wireless communication, for example, the TinyOS. And then real-time operating system. Operating system requiring that processes is done in times to influence future action. Real-time means deterministic response time, not necessarily fast, but deterministic. And we have the hard real-time operating system, which provide absolute warranty that a certain action will occur by a certain time, and soft real-time operating system, the one where the operating system, even though it's not desirable, may miss every now and then a deadline. Example are real-time Linux, QNX. But remember, real-time, what is very important is not the operating system is fast, but it is deterministic. For instance, a real-time operating system may control, you know, a hard supporting device. And here in this case, what it is important is not that it is fast, because we know that the heart beat at a given amount of time, but that the time is never missed. And you can also imagine then the implication that this has with respect to programming language which are used to program them. We have then smart card operating system, which referred to smart card, and these are very small operating system which run on smart card, as we said, which are credit card size devices containing a CPU chip. And there are Java-oriented smart cards, which means that the ROM of one smart card holds and interpreted for the Java virtual machine, and Java applet can run on there. And this is about it, our first lecture. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you have time, don't worry, please send us email or messages on Telegram. See you at the next lecture.